So welcome to this session of the second international EU-China Literary Festival. Today we will talk about this session that is about the different genres that we have in literature. So we have with us Halina Pawlowská, and we have Indrek Hargla, Tao Wenyu,
Okay.
Okay, so I will start to introduce the authors that we have here. And with us we have Halina Pawlowská. Is a successful Czech playwriter, short story writer, journalist, and editor. She has worked as a screenwriter and show presenter for Czech television. She wrote more than 30 novels. So a big round of applause to Halina.
首先呢，我们介绍的第一位作家呢叫 Halina，她是一位非常成功的捷克剧作家，她同时呢还是短篇小说家、记者、编辑。她在捷克电视台呢担任编辑和节目主持人，她已经出版了有超过30本的小说了，欢迎她。
And then we have from Estonian, Indrek Hargla. And he has been a freelance author since 1999, when he sold his first science fiction novel. He has won the Estonian Science Fiction Award 17 times and has published 4 short fiction collections of science fiction and horror. He is best known domestically and internationally as a writer of the Apothecary Malkior medieval crime novels. He has written several stage plays and TV screenplays. A round of applause for him.
那么第二位呢是我们的Indrek Hargla，他呢是1999年呢就发表了第一部中篇科幻小说之后呢，成为了一位自由撰稿人。那么他获得了17次爱沙尼亚的科幻小说大奖。 已经出版了4部短篇科幻和恐怖故事集，而且他现在是为国内外文学界所熟知的一部作品呢，就是犯罪小说，中世纪犯罪小说《梅尔基奥钥匙》。同时呢，他还创造了多部舞台剧和电视剧剧本，均在欧洲各国获得了巨大的成功，所以非常欢迎他。
He's from Suzhou. He's a poet, writer, painter, member of the Chinese Writers Association, a national first-level author, and editor of Suzhou magazine. His poetry collections include Trojan Horse Rider, and his essay collections include Taihu Memories and Suzhou Flavor. So a round of applause for him.
那么我们今天第三位嘉宾呢是陶文瑜陶先生，陶先生呢是一位苏州诗人，同时呢还是作家、书画家，还有中国作家协会的会员，国家一级作家，同时是苏州杂志社的主编。那么他著有的诗集呢有《木马骑手》，还有散文集《太湖十记》《徽州十记》《苏轼滋味》《红莲白藕》等等，欢迎他。
We have also Fang Wei. He was born in Bingzhou, Shandong, and has a PhD in literature. He is professor of liberal arts, a visiting scholar of Suzhou University in Taiwan. He has published dozens of stories in major journals. He won the Zijin Mountain Literature Award, and he won with his novel, The Age of Heroes. So applause to him as well.
来的这位嘉宾呢是房伟先生，房伟先生是山东滨州人，他是文学博士，还是教授。 同时呢，他还获得了因为长篇小说《英雄时代》获得了紫金山文学奖，同时在台湾东吴大学做访问学者，还发表了数十篇小说。欢迎他。
That tonight we have here authors that are very successful in their own style of writing, and I know that all of them almost wrote all the genres, but I will focus on some specific genres that each of them are specialized, and I have a special question for each of them regarding this difference in genre.
那么相信大家都知道我们在座的这些作家呢都是非常成功的作家，同时呢他们也都有自己擅长的风格，当然了可能对于每一位作家来讲他都会涉及多个题材，但是今天呢我们就主要针对每一个作家他特别擅长的一个题材，可能每一个作家我都会有相应的问题来提问，让我们大家呢来分享一下他们对于特定的题材有什么想法。
Okay, so I have the first question is forIndrek, and I want to ask you, what is the most important characteristic of a science fiction novel? And also if you can elaborate what that is, maybe some people in the audience doesn't know, so you can explain what it is, and also maybe some characteristic from Estonian science fiction that we know you are such a big name in this genre.
那么首先第一个问题啊是给 Andrew 先生，给 Andrew 先生呢他是我们都知道他是擅长写科幻小说，那么在科幻小说这一特定的题材他有什么特点呢？给大家希望能够给大家介绍一下爱沙尼亚科幻小说他的世界。
Yes, well, science fiction probably has always been, and rightly so, as a literature of tomorrow, literature of futureIn science fiction, we ask questions how our world will change, how a human being will change, how the technological changes will affect us. Let's say, starting from the 80s, the authors have predicted the modern world of technology to some extent, and their question have always been, would a human being still...remain human when all this technology around us is developing into the spheres we cannot even imagine at the moment. Also, what would happen if technology and digital technology will get inside the human? How will human change? I wrote quite a lot of science fiction stories about religion.I wrote one story, for instance, about the universe, where the God, the existence of God, is scientifically proved. The God is not a supernatural creature or anything people can relate only in their minds. God is something scientific.How our world will change, and my answer was that this world is doomed. The world doesn't need a scientifically proved God. Human doesn't need such a God. But also, yes, science fiction has always been, it had some sort of warning effect. It has warned us. Oh, sorry, yeah.
That's fine, no problem.
是这样子的，那么科幻小说呢它主要是写未来，就是预测未来的世界是什么样子的，世界会变成什么样，人会变成什么样，科学技术发生什么样的变化，它又对人造成什么样的影响。那么作者，科幻小说的作者，他呢就是起一个预测未来这么一个作用。那么在未来随着科技的迅速发展，有很多是我们难以想象的一些新科技可能会完全颠覆我们的世界观，我们的认知。那那个时候人仍然是人吗？会发生什么样巨大的变化呢？或者是说甚至有一些数字科技它能够嵌入人脑，那么它带来的变化可能是更加巨大的。我的作品呢同时还会有跟宗教有关系，其中一部作品呢我写的是有关宇宙的，那么就是上帝的系统 上帝已经为人们所认知的一个系统遭到了破坏，它不再是一个超自然的能量，那么世界将要变成什么样子呢？在我的小说里面，这个世界基本上是变成一个世界末日的一个状态了，人类不需要这么样的一个God 这么样一个神的存在。那么另外一点就是科幻小说它的一个特点就是起一个警示作用。 Just about the warning, go.
Yeah, some sort of a warning sign or asking questions what would happen to, are we really happy with the predictable development of certain technologies. Also, it seems to me that many modern authors ask the question, why are we really developing all this technology? Now, are we doing it only to live in more comfort? Is it only for our own, to improve our life quality, or does it have any further and more, let's say, higher aim, higher goal? Are we creating all the digital world around us to become more aware of the world, or just creating more comfort for us? About Estonian science fiction, I should probably quickly say that we are using quite a lot of our folklore in science fiction, using mythological creatures as well, and a lot of myth, our folk tales, bringing them into modern world, mixing things up. Science fiction has always been an adventure, adventure and entertainment. That is very important in that kind of literature.
那么接着刚才讲的警示作用，警示作用会起一个什么样的目的？就是说，到那个时候人会开心吗？这个世界发生的变化是不是可以预测的？是不是可以掌控的？很多作者，就是科幻小说的作者，都会问这么一个问题：为什么世界发展得如此之快？为什么要照这个趋势来发展？那么，我们可以理解的一个原因就是说，很多科技，包括数字革命、数字科技，它都是为了让我们的人类的生活水平、生活质量变得更高，让人类变得更加舒适。但是，这对精神世界又有一个什么样的影响呢？同时呢，第三点就是对于我的作品来讲，说会把古神话啊，古希腊神话呀，或者古神话一类的人物、造型概念来融入到现代社会，那么他们之间发生怎么样的结合，怎么样的冲突
？Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. It is really interesting subject, and it's so interesting to know more about science fiction and its characteristics. Okay, so. My next question is for Tao Wenyu, and in a different note, that is going to be a big contrast, but I would like to ask you, what do you think is the most important characteristic for poetry?
那么我接下来的这个问题呢，是给陶先生的。陶先生的作品风格跟 Indrek 可能就差别很大了哈。但是我想问陶先生的一个问题，就是说，您认为诗歌这么一个题材，它最大的特点是什么？
这个我建议啊，就是一位作家讲完以后，大家鼓鼓掌，就是给大家鼓励一下。刚才那个这先生讲完以后，大家鼓鼓掌，他开心的，对吧？那个我跟这位先生区别在什么呢？他展望未来，我呢？不是活在当下，而是更看重从前。我觉得我们在大步的向前走的时候，回过头来看一眼，回味一下从前的生活更有意思。那我觉得比如我的诗歌和散文其实这个成分都多一点，就是说我觉得一个作家要看的就是他通过他的思想啊，是用艺术形式表现出来，主要是他艺术的表现是最重要的。刚才什么问题啊？我忘了。
诗歌是这个，诗歌的它的特点，您认为写诗歌它的主要的特点是什么？
我觉得就是自己。其实每个人都有不同的自己，他就是说，有人可能境界高一点，读的书多一点，天赋好一点；有人差一点。你坚守住自己，其实自己是最博大的。就是我从自己的心灵出发，就走下去，坚持住。像我这个年纪，就是守住自己， 是最主要的。就是其实我觉得所有的艺术门类包括诗歌啊，就是坚守自己，然后就是表达出一个和别人不同的自己，这是最主要的。谢谢大家。
So I suggest that because Indrek gave a wonderful remark, should we give him a round, a warm applause of applause? And for science fiction, it's focused on the future. But for me, for the things I love, the poem, I think it's more about reminiscing the past. When you look into the past, you may find it more interesting. Something's more interesting when you look back, and you need to reminisce and you need to think about things. It becomes different. I mostly focused on poems and prose. For me, I think of the authors, writing poems is about to deliver their ideas, to express what they think. And I think the most obvious feature for poems is about yourself. You need to know yourself. You need to know what you feel, what you like, what you don't like. Understand yourself and persist in your own way. Because I think the people by itself is the most profound.
Thank you very much. Yeah, so this is a different genre, and as Tao Wenyu were saying, science fiction maybe looks at the future and poetry looks at the past. So moving on, I have a question for Halina Pawlowská. So you are maybe the most famous female writer in Czech Republic, and you write many genres, including novels, and you write many different kind of books. But I know that you also write script for movies. Would you like to talk a little bit about the process of writing such a specific genre, and that has so much to do with literature, but has also to do with multimedia production? Could you just talk a little bit about what you think it's important in a script for a movie?
那么我接下来的一个问题呢，是对海琳娜的。同时呢，与刚才我们陶先生已经讲了，就是说诗歌呢，包括他自己的作品，一般就是倾向于对过去的一个回头看的这么一个过程。然后那个科幻小说呢，是关于走向看向未来的，这是他们的一个不同的题材的一个不同点。那么关于海琳娜呢，她是捷克最著名最成功的小说家了，她写了有长篇小说，写了不同的各种书，同时她还为电影写剧本。那么对海琳娜的问题呢，就是说在您写剧本的过程中，您认为这个她结合了文学与又要迎合大众媒体的口味，这么这是一个怎么样的过程？
I wrote about 50 short TV scripts for and 30 books and 6 movies. And when I want to compare my work, I must have that I love writing books and I hate writing scripts. And because it's really very difficult at teaching writing scripts, and I can tell you what is so difficult in one sentence. Because when you are watching movie, you must know that when you want to write it, everything what you see must be written, and everything what you hear must be written, but nothing else, only this. So you have to write scripts without feelings, without sense, only what are you see, what are you hear. And it's difficult when you want to say something interesting and intelligent and you know. sophisticated, heavy, and so forth. So,
我呢，我写了有50本啊，就是电视剧本，那30部书，还有6个电影的剧本。但是当我比较他们的时候，我非常清楚，我很喜欢写书，我特别讨厌写剧本。是我同时更比较有反差意义的是说，我还在学校教书，教什么呢？就教写作剧本。 其实为什么我讨厌写剧本呢？是因为，当看电影的时候，你们观众呢所看到的、所听到的，可能对于你们只是一个直观的感受，但是你们看到的、听到的，我都要把它化成文字来写出来。有时候就要不带任何感情的、不带任何的感官色彩的去把它给客观的给写出来。我觉得这个是非常难的。
Okay, thank you very much. So it's a very tough job to write the script. Okay, and now we have Fang Wei. Of course, he wrote other genres as well, but he's a famous scholar. So he writes a lot of papers, theses. So to make a contrast with what we already talked, I would like to ask you in a more maybe academic way, what is the most important thing when you write an academic paper regarding literature?
那么刚才从哈琳娜的演讲中我们可以知道哈，确实写剧本好难哈。然后接下来呢，我们的问题是给房伟房先生，房先生的作品呢肯定是各个题材都有涉及的啦，但是呢，他也是一个大家都知道是一个著名的学者。 那么呢，我给您的问题就是说，以您的角度来看，在学术论文，因为您肯定写了很多论文嘛，学术方面的著作，在学术著作方面，您觉得跟文学的结合，那么学术著作它又是一个怎么样的一个特点？
谢谢，其实这个说不上是个著名的啊，这本这个说不上，这个问题其实也是我经常被问到的，因为在高校里面，这个一方面呢，我们要 写学术论文是一个非常严谨的这样一个题材，另一方面呢，我自己的这个业余爱好也特别喜欢创作，那么尤其是小说的创作，那么这个其实就是在很多人看来这是一个互相打架的一个东西，那么但其实在我看来呢，这个专业的分工啊，也只是我们一个人为的设定，啊，那么不同的文体它有不同的这样的文体的要求。 那么对于学术的文章而言，我觉得它可能更多的是有一种理性的这样的一种思考，那么它需要一个比较严谨的这样的一个构思，比较理性的这样的一个梳理和比较这个我觉得这个非常简洁的这样的一个表述。但是对于文学而言，我想更多的可能要注重它的创意。那么也就是说，我们经常有一句话叫脑洞，啊，我们现在我们这个流行的一句话。那么也就是说你在你的创作之中， 不管是你写小说还是写其他的题材，有没有一个让我们觉得眼前一亮的、特别新的东西？啊，那么这个中国有一句古话叫"相国之死"，那么文学创作其实是一个非常喜新厌旧的这么一个行业，啊，它需要有不断的新的东西的出现，新的创意，啊，新的思想、新的表现方式，那么这个在新和旧之间的这种结合，其实对我来说，我觉得也是一种挑战。但是呢，我觉得学术呢是我所好。 这个创作呢，意味我所好。那么二者呢，我想继续还是要努力的把它结合好。好，谢谢。So first of all,
I'm not that famous, and people often ask me this question, and I think that for the academic papers, it's more about the rigorous writing. I need to be rigorous and very severe, serious maybe sometimes. But for literature, it's about creation. You need to be creative. So that there seems to be a conflict, the creation and the rigorous writing. But I think these genres are just some category that defined by people. We will not be bounded by that genre. For me, I like writing academic papers. I like to be rigorous, but also I like to be creative. So separately speaking, for the academic paper, you need rigorous conceiving, and you need the reasoning, the logic behind, and then you need to simply put it put it in a very simple way for people to understand. And for literature, of course, you need to be creative. We always say brainstorming, you need to think and think, you need years to write something called literature. And only, I think that only for people who likes to the new ideas can be like alive and vigorous every day. So for me, I like to combine the old thing, the traditional way of reasoning and receiving, and the new modern thing. I like to combine them. So one sentence, I like write the academic papers, and I also like to be creative for the literature.
Thank you very much. Next question is for everyone, and it doesn't need to be a very long answer, but I would like to know for you, all of you, what is your favorite book and why? So we can start with Indra.
那么接下来的这个问题呢，是我们所有的作者都有的一个问题啦。回答呢不一定长，也可以简短，随自己喜欢。问题呢就是说，您最喜欢的一本书是什么？我们先从 Indra 开始。
Yeah, well, I never asked myself that question, actually. That's why I think I haven't probably met yet a book in the world that the one that I can call really the book I love most. I'm still searching, and I hope that there isn't one in the world that I could keep on searching for all my life.
Okay, but what book?
Okay. 首先就是说，我从来没有问过自己这个问题，就是我最喜欢的书是哪一本书，因为我现在还没有找到我最爱的一本书。我希望有这么一本书存在，这样子我可以一直寻找，就好像这个华山论剑哈，我要找到那个最匹配我内心的渴望的那本书。
Okay, then maybe you can think about it for a while and tell us what books. Inspired you most to start your writing career, but you don't need to answer straight away. We will talk to people and then go back to you.
那么呢，也许那个 Indrek 先生可以先想一想，就是或者说有没有哪本书对自己的启发最大的，启发了自己的创作灵感。那么一会儿啊 ，Indrek 如果想到了，我们再来采访他。可以其他的作家先说一下。
Yes. So, now maybe Tao Wenyu.
其实这个问题就是说，我觉得跟年龄有关。我从年轻长到现在，就是有很多喜欢的书，那一个时期一本书，比如那个杰克好兵帅克，我就很喜欢。但是我到现在长到这个年纪，就老了以后啊，我就喜欢我自己的书。我觉得只有喜欢自己啊，你才能坚持住自己，并且走得更远。所以我如果要回答我现在最喜欢的一本书，就是我写的书。
I think the question is more related with age. When I was growing up, I liked many, many different books. I like the one, do you know the English name of the Jack, the book you mentioned? 你刚才讲的那个英文书 Do you know the English name? Yeah, it's called Jack or something. That book is one of his
Jack
favorites.
Jack Kerouac.
Yes. But...When I turned into my current age, I think the favorite of the book is what I wrote. I love my own books.
Very well. It's also possible to write his favorite book. Okay, so now we move to Halina.
Okay, I prefer your two questions. The second question.
Yeah.
Which book influenced my career? When I was around 12 years old, I read one small book from German author. His name was Peter Altenberg, and he wrote story, very short, minute story. This story had only maximum 15 sentences, and I love it. I loved it, and I love it.
那么对于我来讲呢，就是我在十二岁的时候读到了一本德国作家的一本书，德国作家叫 Screenwriter， 很难读念的一个名字。他那个书啊，其实里面都是非常短的小故事，可能一个故事也就15句话的样子，但是那本书从始到终都是我的最爱。
方威，
刚才几位老师都讲了他们心目中自己的这个喜欢的书，其实我觉得这个喜欢的作品呢，可能是这个最喜欢可能会有一个阶段性，那么也就是说年龄的阶段啊，那么他会有不同的喜欢的书，所以你让我说这个最喜欢哪一本，可能我觉得很难举出来，可能要说哪几本，这个我还能说出来。其实在我的学生时代呢，我觉得可能我最喜欢的还是水浒传啊，为什么？因为我是一个山东人啊，山东这个水浒传呢，很多的发生的故事也在我的故乡发生的，那么我喜欢里面的他描述的这样一种江湖世界和人的这种豪侠义气的东西，那么这个是当时在我读书的时代是特别的让我着迷的一个东西。那么我长大之后呢，可能对我影响比较大的，我想就是摆在上面的这本书，这个王小波传里面提到的一个作家王小波，那么他的有一个中篇小说叫《黄金时代》，那么我认为是我成年以后大学毕业以后那么对我影响最深的这个大陆作家之一。好，谢谢。
So all of the other authors the writers have told us what is their favorites. For me, I think that this question is also related with age, because you're at different ages, you may like different books. So it's quite hard for me to just name one book, because I think there are many books that I love. And I want to mention one that is when I was a student.I read a book, it's called 水浒传 in Chinese, but it actually means the 108 heroes. It's about it's a very old dynasty. And in that book, it features the brotherly feeling and the bravery of these heroes. I am quite attracted by them. And when I grown up, I found one novelist, who is called Wang Xiaobo.Is quite famous in China. He has a book, it's called Golden Age. That is my favorite. I think Wang Xiaobo is the writer that I love most ever since my graduation.
Thank you very much. Finally, a concrete answer. Joking. Okay, Indrek, do you want to come back to this topic or?
Yes, I probably could mention one book. This is significant because when I was a small kid, my grandmother used to read me it aloud, so I remembered it very well. And now when I'm 47, now I'm editing an anthology of original science fiction stories based on that book. The book is called The Ancient Folk Tales of Estonian Nation.It was first published in 1863, and actually it was the first Estonian language fiction book at all in the world. So Estonian literature started from writing down the folk tales, and it has influenced our literature and our culture hugely.Tremendously. Probably this book in Estonian, it's called Eesti Rahva Enemu Instituut.
Sounds great.
也许我可以来举一个例子，有一本书对我的影响也是非常大的，但我很小的时候啊，我的妈妈就经常大声的读给我这本书，给我读给我听，那也是一个科幻小说类的。这本书呢是1863年发表的，是爱沙尼亚的第一批小说，是非常著名的一个小说集。这本书呢就是开启了我对文学的认知。
Thank you very much.So, moving on, I have a different question, and it's for all of you. Okay. Do you want each book to stand on its own, or are you trying to build a body of work with connections between the books.
那么接下来的这个问题呢，也是对我们所有作家提问的一个问题，就是说，在您在创作一部作品的时候呢，是倾向于这个作品是一个独立的存在呢，还是倾向于说跟您的其他作品有关联，或者跟别人的其他作品有关联的一个小说，一个作品
？Maybe we can start this time with Fang Wei.
其实我在2016年开始呢，这个创作了有一个系列的。这个历史小说，那么主要是针对的中国这个近现代历史，那么也就是说其实我个人有一个喜好，那么也就是说在创作小说的时候啊，我喜欢让它成为一种成系列的这样一种感觉啊。那么比如说我这一组呢，大部分都是有关于中国近现代史，尤其是关于针对于这个中国的抗战历史，那么我喜欢用这样一组作品来表达我对这样一个比较长的一个历史阶段的这样一个整体性的认识，啊，这是我个人的一种偏好。那么这个从2018年开始呢，我现在又开始写一个民国的系列。那么刚刚就是发表了一个关于鲁迅的小说。那么这个民国系列呢，主要是写民国的名人。那么这一组打算写五个中短篇，啊，那么这是我可能我个人的一个偏好。当然，我觉得这个写作呢，每个人有每个人的不同的路数啊，条条大路通罗马，每个人有他不同的这样的方式。那么有没有和自己的作品相关，或者说与别人相关，这个可能还是要主要看这个作家自己他对这个作品的这样一个定位，以及他对自己的一个定位，我想这可能是比较重要的一个问题啊。谢谢。
So the case about me is that in 2016, I wrote a series of history fiction is about the modern and the contemporary history of China. So when I was creating a book, I always tend to write it into a series because it's based on a very long stage. It's based on a very long period of history. So it may not be able to sum up in just one book. And recently,focusing on another series is based on the period right after the liberation of China, and one of the book is about Lu Xun. It's just my preference. I think everyone has his own way. About the connection other books, it's always about the author himself. What is the positioning of his book? Does he want it to be related with other books or not?
Thank you very much. Moving on, maybe to Indrek.
Yes, I wrote several trilogies of novels and this ancient medieval crime novel series that have now six novels. So the serial approach gives you a little bit more.Way to expand the universe and the story. You just cannot put the whole universe you want to create or you are feeling would be interesting for readers to experience in one book. So this serialization gives you a couple of more options. But I think best novels in the world, they are all standalone novels, and something may get lost in serialization or so. So I think I truly believe in this that the good novel should stand alone no matter where, when, which nationality is the author from. The good novel really should speak itself.From itself and be understandable for everyone.
那么大家也知道了，我的写小说是犯罪小说。那么现在的这一本犯罪小说呢，《药剂师》这个已经有六本了，是一个系列小说。因为我为什么把它写成一个系列呢？是因为它可以扩展在时间、空间上，整个宇宙进行无限的扩展，给人更多的选择。但是呢，我同时也认为。一部伟大的作品，它同时应该也是脱离于其他的一个独立存在的一个个体，因为它就可以不论你是在什么地方，不论你在哪个国家， 或者发生在哪个朝代，他这个作品都栩栩如生，都非常有非常强大的生命力，能让很多人能够感同身受。
Thank you very much. Now we pass to Tao Wenyu.
这个问题啊，我想打个比方，就是京剧，就是大家共同的文学，比如，那京剧呢，就是一个大家共同的舞台，我们表现着一个共同的故事。但是个人有个人的唱腔，我一定要有自己的唱腔。我觉得这是所谓的，就是说，和别人的相同和不同，就是我是表现的是相同的，是大家表现的是京剧，但不同的，我有我自己做到的唱腔，可能就是这个意思。
I think I'll just give an example. It's like Beijing opera. It offers a common stage, everyone. We all sing Beijing opera, but everyone has his own way, has his own style of singing. I sing in this way, but the other one may like it to be the other way. So it's about the common and the difference.
Thank you very much. And Halina?
Thank you, Sarah, that you give me time for thinking about my answer, because I didn't understand it. But I'm not sure that I understand this question. And it's not in language. I understand the sense of this question. Not very good, you know. I'm a comedy writer. Yeah, it's what I can tell you. And so I think when I'm looking for funny situations in very difficult human life, and I believe and I hope that it will be in the future very important to finding these nice things, and so it's all I can.
Tell you about it. Okay. Thank you. 首先感谢Sarah 把这个时间留给我，让我最后一个发言。其实我这个并不是语言的问题，Sarah 说的解释的问题呢是非常清楚的，只是我呢需要一个时间去消化这么深刻的一个问题。对于我呢，我对比较倾向于比较喜欢的就是说来描述在人的生活中这些。比较有意思的或者是光怪陆离的现象，同时呢我认为就是一定要不论是什么样的情况，一定要人要追寻生活中的美好的事物。
Thank you very much. And the next question I would like to ask, if when you write, it's also for everyone, and when you write, do you try to be originalor to deliver to the reader what they want. So if you try to be original and stand on your own point of view, not caring what the public is going to expect, or if you have this in mind, if you think maybe I should write this topic or approach it in this way because it's going to be easier for the writer on, or it's going to have more success and sell more books. So,
那么接下来的这个问题呢，也是给大家所有人的，就是当您在写作在创作的时候，您是倾向于原创呢，比如说就是倾向于我有什么样的一个想法，我想要表达一个什么样的事情，什么我怎么想的，还是说更照顾读者的想法，比如说我可能这样写读者会比较喜欢，就是更倾向于从自己内心出发呢，还是更倾向于从读者这个层面来去出发？
Maybe I will start with Indrek.
Yeah, thank you. It's a very tricky question because I feel it kind of forces me to confess something or to reveal some tricks in or secrets in literary craft that are probably best kept hidden. Yeah. But first thing, I think every writer should have its own voice. Without that, everything, all the books would be like the same. So if you have your own voice, and if you are confident, and if you really trust in it, then you can write anything. Of course, you need to be original, but don't overdo it. I mean, don't be too pretentious. I try to be, I think of myself as a very traditional writer. I write in traditional genres, crime fiction, science fiction, but these genres, especially science fiction, demands of author that you write a story, you need to have something new in it, something original. Otherwise, you probably wouldn't have even wrote it, but science fiction authors need this originality always. And in crime fiction, well,
Yes, 对于我来讲，我认为就是不论创作什么样的题材，都要有自己的声音。如果没有自己的声音、自己的想法，这些新颖的想法，所有的书都会看起来都是一样的内容了。就是我们要自信，要遵从内心。我个人来讲是一个比较传统的一个作家，我写的像犯罪小说也是一个传统的题材，但是我仍然坚持认为写作一定要有发自自己内心的东西，就是原创性的东西一定要出来。
In crime fiction, there are some rules, and obviously the author is obliged to follow the rules. So you are asked to be original, entertain us, be original, but please follow the rules. Otherwise, it would get too messy, and the readers have. Genre readers, they have certain expectations if they're reading in certain genres. So when I'm writing crime stories, I try always to surprise the readers with something. The voice or approach of the author must have something that is very personal and only this author has.
那么在创作犯罪小说的时候呢，它其实是有犯罪小说的一个规则在的。在创作的过程中，我还是会遵循这些规则，因为如果不遵循这个犯罪小说的一个内在的逻辑、内在的规则的话呢，很容易就读着就丧失耐心了，就读不下去了。这是一些最基本的，就是要迎合读者的一个地方，就是这个小说本身它的一个规则性。但是同时呢，我会注重一个惊奇的转折，就是我会设定一个你想不到的一个转折，这样子才让我的小说变得更有意思。
Thank you very much. Next, to answer the question, how will
you? 我觉得生活或者原型啊，就像是水上的船，它一定要贴着水面，离开水面就不能走。而我们的创作是什么呢？是水鸟，它有时候贴着水面，有时候就飞向天空了。我就向往并且追求我的文字啊，是飞上天空的那个瞬间，就这种感觉。我是一个不善言辞的人，所以比较简短一点啊。
Since I'm not good at speaking, so I will just summarize in two sentences. I think that.Fluctuation, the relation is like the water and the bird. Sometimes the bird is on the water, but all of a sudden the bird is flying away, far away from the water. To me, I like the moment when the bird is flying away. I like that moment, and I want to focus on that moment.
Thank you very much. Halina, when you write, you have your...audience in mind, your public in mind when you write, or you want to write what you feel it's different and original and not think about the readers.
那么对海琳娜的问题呢，就是说在您在创作的时候是不是经常是在想着读者，就是说读者想要什么呢，我是不是要给读者表达什么东西，还是说你就完全不顾读者，在一直在自己心里面想的是什么，就让它完全给涌现出来。
I'm not thinking about my readers. I'm writing only what I feel and what I want to say, what I think is funny or what what I think that it's important to tell in this moment to somebody. And if some are thousands of people, readers, it's fine. And it's, you know, when I am reading, it's for me, it's my job. But it's nice job. So it must be interesting and fun for me. This is the first.
我认为啊，首先呢，在我创作的过程中，我是不会说老是想着读者这回事的。我就是我此时此刻想到了什么，我在想什么，我特别想说什么，或者是很有意思的一件事情，或者是非常搞笑的，或者是怎么样，只要是我在此时此刻我特别想说的，也许我是对某个人想说，或者是说呢，我是对这些上千个读者想说，就是对谁想说无所谓，是读者也无所谓，但是我就是从内心出发说我想说的东西。写作是我的一个工作，如果它没有意义的话，如果它不是有意思的一个工作，我觉得会很累的，所以我要把写作变成一个非常有意思的一个过程。
Quite good.
Good.
Thank you. Now, Fang Wei.
我其实是很同意前面几位这个老师们还有作家们讲的这个观点。啊，其实每一个作家在他自己刚开始创作的时候，我想可能都没有过多的去考虑有关于等等因素。他可能在内心啊，我觉得大家都有一种在创作的时候都会有一种冲动。那么这种冲动就是要把我想到的，把我认为是非常重要的东西啊，用我自己非常独特的这种语言呐、啊、包括故事啊啊，或者说其他的形式来表达出来。那么我想这都是每一个作家在他创作的时候都会有这样一种冲动。那么因此呢，我认为是这个首先最重要的，那么可能还是首先要感动自己。那比如说就我而言呢，我自己从事历史小说的创作，那我觉得你首先你不管要去写一个什么样的故事，能不能感动你自己，那如果你这个故事你都觉得自己觉得很虚假，感动不了自己，那我想他也不会去能够感动其他的读者。那么这是第一点。那么第二点呢，我觉得可能对于你的表述来说的话，尽管我们是从一个自我的出发啊，从我自己的这种艺术的个性出发，寻找这种自己这种能感动自己的独特的表现形式，但是呢，我觉得朴素也是非常重要的。那么也就是说，你的表现情感，你的表现技巧，那么一定要是朴素的啊。那么只有在朴素的这样的基础之上，我觉得这个作为作者呢，才能最大的限度的和这个读者产生一种心灵的共鸣。那么在这种共鸣之中啊，你自己的这种非常独特的感受就会得到啊，那么我觉得大众的心，得到读者的心。那么这个时刻呢？啊，我认为这是一个作家最幸福的时刻。谢谢。
I totally agree with what other writers say about their ideas, and to me, I think, at the beginning of the writing, most of the authors don't think about the readers. It's more about the passion, the impulse inside of you. You want to express it, to deliver it.Because it's quite important to you, you want to express it by languages, by novels, etc. I think the first thing that is most important is that you need to touch yourself first. I'm writing history novels. I think you need to touch yourself first. Without aid, you cannot touch anybody. And secondly, I think that, sure, you need to always to...start from what you think, stick with the originality, but also remember to use your language to put it quite simple. So simple as that the readers can relate to the author, so that the readers will love you.
Thank you very much. So we have these two authors coming from Europe, Indrek and Halina.And we have Chinese authors. The next question is also a very, a question that requires a quick answer.
And I want you to tell me, according to your experience in China, which is different because Indrek and Halina are just here for a few days and only know Shanghai. But of course, our local writers know China very well. But anyway, I would like you to tell me, what genre is China for you? Can you begin with the following?
对，so 我们今天有来自欧洲的作家，也有两位来自中国本地的作家。那么我想问大家一个问题，可能就比较简单的回答也可以答，就是根据你们在中国的经历，当然了，欧洲的两位作家也才来没几天，可能他们的感想跟经历跟我们在中国本地的作家是完全不一样的。但是不论如何吧，我的问题呢，就是说中国对于你们来讲是什么样一个题材？
啊，我觉得这是一个特别好，也是一个非常关键的问题。那么我觉得中国呢，这个是一个正在飞速发展的这么一个国家。那么作为一个从现代的角度来讲，那么它其实是一个，就是我们讲通常意义上讲叫未完成的状态啊。那么也就是说，整个从中国这个社会来讲，它的现代化进程啊，那么从一个有十几亿人口的、有一个庞大的国土的这样一个国家，它在走向现代的这样的过程中，它是充满了故事的。啊，我觉得这是目前我觉得我们中国作家非常幸福的一点。那么我们身处于一个充满了故事的这种年代，啊，特别是我想起了就是狄更斯在他的这个作品中经常谈到的一句话。那么也就是说呢，这是一个最好的年代，这也是一个最坏的年代。那么通过这一讲呢，那么目前呢，对我们的这种时代的感受也是这样，啊，它充满了各种的可能性，充满了矛盾，啊，也充满了发展的可能性。所以这个呢，我觉得是给我们这个当代的中国作家提出了这样一个，我觉得呢，这个丰富的挑战，啊，那么就是也就是说的通俗一点的话，也就是说正因为中国的这种发展，我们才有了这个很多故事可写，啊，各种各样的迁徙的故事，那么代际的故事，啊，那么地域的故事，那么这些故事呢，都给了我们各种各样新鲜的文学表述的经验，那么我觉得这个是非常有意思的，啊，那么这么也我想这个可能是跟发达国家这个有一定的差别，那么作为发达国家呢，他们是一个已经啊完成了的这种现代状态，那么已经完成的现代状态，它就会产生一种差异，这个差异性这个就是啊这个叫差异性就在减小。那么这种差异性的减小其实是不利于文学啊，当然这是我个人的一种体验啊，不一定对，让大家这个可以去讨论这个问题啊，谢谢。
I think that it is really a nice and key question. For China, it is a country that is developing. It is developing, it's not developed. In the modern world, you know, China, it has a population of millions of people and it's a very vast land.It's full of stories. For Chinese writers and authors, they are quite blessed because China is so vast, it's filled with all different kinds of stories. Just like what Dickens said in his book, it is the best time, it is the worst time also. So with the different possibilities of the modern China, there are conflicts, there are developing stories, it may pose some challenge to the Chinese authors. Just because of China is in a fast development, so we have a lot of stories to write. We can write about generations, we can write about different places, and comparing with the developed country, there is a gap between us and the developed country. But the gap is decreasing. What I think is thatThis kind of decrease of the gap between us and the developed countries is not a good thing for the authors to write. It's just my opinion.
Thank you very much. Very interesting opinion. And would like to answer next. Indrek?
Yeah. Yes, very simple question. What genre is China to me? Yeah? Well, I should probably mention then that horror, but in a good way. because, well, purely speaking only in terms of literature, yes, I mean, China was like 20 years ago or something, I was reading ghost stories of Biu Songling that were translated into Estonia, and I think these Chinese ghost stories have probably influenced me, everyone that is that you like or that you find excellent in literature somehow influences the author. Even if you don't want it, or even if you don't admit it. But, well, so, let's say folklore horror is, in terms of literature, the genre of China to me. Is that the right answer?
Yeah? There's no right answer. Yeah. They are all right.
Okay, and maybe also I know that there are some I haven't read them myself, but I know that there are some very ancient Chinese crime novels. The crime novel was probably invented in China, so I'm just a follower of this tradition, an aspirant of crime fiction.
对于我来讲哈，中国是什么题材？中国是一个恐动小说的题材，这是一个褒义词。因为我们讲的是根据他自己的经历嘛，是因为他呢，在二十多年前，他读到了一个就是关于中国的鬼故事，是翻译成爱沙尼亚文的，那个鬼故事啊，对他也有一定的影响，所以他就对中国的一个印象呢，其中一个印象就是民间鬼故事。当然了，他呢现在也知道中国呢有一些比较好的关于古代的一些犯罪小说，他还没有写这方面的小说，但是呢也希望能够更多的接触。
Thank you very much, Halina. What do you think?
Yes. I can tell that for me is now China. As genre, very short story because I am here from Monday.short story with tragic comedy moments. The nice story is that the people which I saw, who I saw, were nice with smile on face and with kind in eyes. It's nice. And the tragic moment was...when I had to go with our ambassador in Czech restaurant in Shanghai. You know, I am for the first time in China and I had to go to Czech restaurant. So it was tragic for me. So the comedy tragic moments in very short story, I'm expecting what will become.
在中国的这个简短的经历告诉我啊，中国对我来讲算是一个戏剧性的小说。首先有好的一方面呢，就是说我在大街上可以看到很多善良的中国人，他们都会对我微笑啊，然后都感觉到浓浓的善意，好客。不好的一方面呢，就是比如说我刚刚到中国的那一天呢，跟着我们的大使，竟然去了一家捷克餐馆。我人到了中国，竟然第一顿饭在捷克餐馆吃的。
我在听他们讲，我就忘了问题是什么问题啊？啊，我觉得对于一个作家来说，其实就是昆德拉一个小说，就生活在别处，就是我写了。一个好作家永远生活在别处的，我写到了，不管是中国的从前或者现在中国的当下，就是有关。然后我不写，中国怎么样跟我无关。比如说我们苏州造有很多地铁，好像几条线，但我从来没，应该是我们这个时代发展的一个代表，但是我从来没乘过这个地铁，就跟我无关了。我到现在还没乘过地铁，就无关了。我觉得一个好作家，他永远自己尊重自己的内心，至于在哪里，哪个国家哪个地方，这不重要。我还强调一句话，就生活在别处。谢谢。
So, just like a novel, it says, life is elsewhere, it's not where you live. So, like the subway, There are many lines in subway, but I never took one of them. So the subway has nothing to do with me. So it's about the experience. If you don't experience something, then that has nothing to do with you.
Thank you very much for your answers, and I think that they were very interesting. I will now open the floor to the audience. So if you want to make a question to the author, please feel free to do it in Chinese or English.
下面是我们的观众互问互答的时间，看大家有没有什么问题可以对我们的作家提问。
就我们经常能够遇到什么问题都能问，你们尽量问那个国外，就外国的来宾啊，就机会难得，你们问他们比较好啊。
Since we two are Chinese writers, so we may see each other more often in the future. So maybe tonight is a good chance for you to ask the foreign writers.
So my question is for Mr. Andrew. It's a small question, I think, because you talked about that in your story where the god, when the god is proved to be scientific, then it's doomed. So I want to hear a little explanation behind it. So because...because as I see, God, scientific or not, doesn't affect anything. So, and another question beneath it is that maybe a philosophic question, that is, what's the meaning or the existence of God?所以我问这个 Idris 的问题是，他刚刚有提到，就是说，当神被上帝被证明是科学性的，而不是超自然的时候，就没有意义了。所以我想让他来做，就关于这一点来做一些解释。然后，这个问题深层的一个大问题就是神明存在的意义是什么，上帝的意义是什么。
Yeah, thank you. In this story, the God that was proved, it was the God as creator. So the creation of the world, the creation of the universe was explained through the action of God, and this God was actually a formula. Scientists were able to find something that was considered to be God, now it was, in this story, it was real, it was formula, the God letter, the God formula. And everything else, this formula said, everything else in the universe is purely imaginational. What was not created by this entity, the rest are your imagination. So basically the God was taken away from people by scientists. That's a story. It just allowed me to put some people, some characters into situations that I made them suffer. I love when my characters suffer. and then the second question.
So after it's explaining it, my second question seemed to be unimportant because I thought that there's some... so after your explanation, I understand that my second question seemed unrelated to my first question. So my original second question is, what's the meaning of the existence of God? It's quite philosophical, but yeah. After its explanation, I understand there's...
That was explanation in that story. Story is a story.
Yeah, story,
okay.
Thank you.
Good.
Yes, Well, explanation of meaning of existence. Well, I think some things exist not existing. I mean, there are things that are not that do not exist as other things. There are many items in this room. We can touch them. We can make pictures of them. We can measure them, and they exist. Some things in the universe do not exist in this way. They won't allow to measure them, to take pictures of them. We cannot scientifically prove the non-existence or existence, but we can feel them. We are able to feel them and know that through this feeling we are able to find some answers and the truth of our own existence. Well, I don't know if it was a philosophical answer, but something like this.
Thank you.
我简短的翻译一下好不好？节省大家的这个问答时间，是这样子的，就在他的小说里面呢，上帝他是一个创造者，他创造了宇宙，他其实作为一个公式，他是一个创造公式，那么其他的都是一个想象。到最后呢，这个上帝就被科学家们所驱逐了。那么他的所有的人物里面，比较倾向于让他的人物进行受苦受难，就是他不喜欢一个就是大家都欢欢喜喜的一个场景，他喜欢让人受难，然后从受难中看到一些东西。关于上帝存在的意义，上帝他就是他的存在是与其他存在是不一样的。比如说在我们房间的这些东西，你都可以看到，可以摸到，它是一种存在的方式。但是另外有一些东西呢，它不是以这种方式存在的，你就不能说它不存在，它是不可以衡量，不可以被证明的，但是你可以感知。像这种可以感知到的，但是不能用我们正常的就是触摸的方式来感觉到的这个一个力量的存在呢，可以帮助我们回答一些我们哲学层面的一个问题。
I think that now we also need to have a round of applause for Iris, our interpreter, because she is translating philosophical answers. Wow. Any more questions? I want to. Yes, please.
你好，我想请问一下那位女士老师，就是我平时的时候吧，就是因为自己也比较喜欢文学嘛，偶尔也写作一些散文啊、诗歌啊。在散文、诗歌写作的时候，那个时候我的状态是感觉非常的自由，跟随我自己的思想，然后笔下就是，文字出来状态就是比较轻松，然后灵感创作也比较多。但是最近呢，我接触了一下，因为我是学戏曲的嘛，需要写戏曲剧本的时候呢，我发现这是完全两个体系。在写到剧本再给观众看的时候，我就会发现当我写作的时候会变得拘谨，有时候会考虑啊，观众这样子写喜不喜欢啊，能不能接受，我就会发现我自己的创作得到了怎么说呢，应该是拘束吧。那请问那个是否您一开始的时候接这种两种体系交换的时候，是否也有这种问题？那又是怎样才能去克服一下呢？
So my question is for Halina. You know, when I was I love literature to begin with. When I was writing the genre of prose and poem, I feel quite free. It's like the ideas.The inspiration just flow and flow very freely, and it's quite easy for me. But you know, because I'm a student, I'm learning opera, and when I was rewriting something about opera, it's very different feeling. I feel nervous. I will think that will the readers like what I'm writing? This kind of nervous idea.Just give me, I don't think I'm confident. So I want to ask you, when you are, you know, transferring between different genres, do you have this kind of awkward nervousness?
You need practice. You know, when it's man, woman is young, the feeling and the senses is very hard and nice and clear, and inspiration is flowing, and it's the most important. But when you are a little bit older, you can use misses, sentences and feeling, and to not be nervous, but very flow and quiet, it's possible to tell in very simple form. I prefer when the form is very simple, and when the form is simple, you can very good tell the content and your mind in this sentences, in this form. Do you understand me? It's okay? Am I explaining for it? Because the word is my destiny. But now I am in very bad situation because I think in Czech, in my mother language, and I have in my head to translate it, and I feel that the translation is very bad, wrong, stupid. I'm not so stupid as like, but it's not a very difficult situation. But I want to answer very serious. So your inspiration is most important. It's yours. It must be. And be quiet and nice, easy form to tell it to the others.
Okay. 首先呢，我认为他说声音可能跟年龄也有一点关系。比如说，在人年轻的时候，你的那个感觉非常的强烈，非常的清晰，你就很容易把它给表达出来。可能就是您在写那个散文还有诗歌的时候的那么一种状态。那么，当人慢慢的长大，上了年龄之后呢，可能就会更倾向于一种更加柔和的、更加缓和的，也是非常简单的一种形式。它也是一种非常自然的一个表达。他刚才插了一句啊，因为他是来自捷克共和国嘛，所以说他那个英语并不是母语的，所以他在转换的过程中、翻译的过程中，突然就会觉得非常的难。这可能是也能某个层面上说一下那个转换的问题。他最后说的呢，就是说灵感是非常重要的，你只要有这个灵感，你就能找到自己的方式。
Is it okay? Any more questions? One question for our Chinese writers as well, if you have another one? Yes?
Sorry. 我的问题是问陶先生的一个问题，就是陶先生有说那个就是自我，就是创作的时候自我很重要。然后我最近有在读一本书，是那个皮格马利翁效应，他讲的是人和人之间是互相创造的，就是说你这个人自己在你接触外界的时候，其实在你不知不觉中你也是被人所创造的。那我想问的就是陶先生说的这个创作来源的这个自我，它的来源是哪里呢？I will try. So, Mr. Tao just mentioned that the self is very important in creating, and so my. But I'm reading a book that tells that people are actually created each other through interactions, and unconsciously you are actually created by others. So I wonder what is the self that Mr. Tao mentioned? What does his self came from? Bad translation.
Very good.
我觉得刚才这个话题是好像是您说的，要不您回答一下。我记得你说了这个话题，我好像没有说过。
It thinks that the question should be addressed to you because it means that you mentioned that. It's also.
I think both things are true, probably. Yeah, because of course we are created because of our ancestors, right? Everything, everything that has been before us, it's in us. I mean, the essence of things is always in the past. What is the present, it's only the surface that doesn't contain the whole story or all information. Genetically, of course, we are created by all our ancestors. But mentally, also, yes, we contain information that relates to our nationality, to our religion, to our preferences, in every way of life, and in that we are influenced greatly by other people. So what is self? Self, in this case, in your case, if it's in the court, let's say, in your case, yourself is the part that you are giving away, or the part of you that influences the others that will come after you. And maybe it's the self is not so important.
Yeah. 因为呢，刚才就是您在说这个中文的时候，说的是 mutually created， 被创造，被互相创造。所以呢，他是从这个创造这个层面先来回答的。他说呢，首先就是，我们呢都是由祖先创造过来的，很多我们过去的历史它蕴藏了很多的智慧，那么已经发生的过去的历史在我们身上有一种体现，现代这个只是一个历史人类历史长河的一个小阶段而已。 我们共同被祖先所创造，这是他的第一个回答。那么第二个回答呢，就是说，在日常生活中，我们人与人之间，由于彼此的沟通，又相互被影响。你自己的一个表现，自己的一个存在，会对他人产生一种影响，而他人又反过来又会对你造成某种影响，就是互相作用的。那么，也许自己并不重要。
重要的就是说你自己只是一个非常微小的存在，也许自己并不重要。好， thank you very much. Fang
Wei,
would like to say something?
没有，他就是说你有没有想说的，要不有没有想说的？没有，这说的很好了。I think the other writers have put it very well. So
Tao Wenyu, no?
没有了，我觉得这个文学啊。 我讲两句话，我觉得就是说我年轻时候看过一句古诗，就是说少年一段风流事，只需佳人独自知。这文学啊，真的很，就是说很私密的，很难交流，所以交流出来的就是泛泛泛而谈。所以我希望就是说今天我们参加这个会，这个就是你们记住这个话，你们听听而已，就是了，我就是这么多，谢谢大家。
When I was young, I read a poem. The affairs of a youngster maybe is not even spoken to his family because it's quite private. For literature, I think it's also quite private. So I think today our gathering is just to talk about some general stuff, not quite private.
Thank you very much. Halina, would you like to say something?
No. Okay. Don't be scared. Okay, so I think that we are out of time. Thank you very much, all the authors present. Thank you very much for your exchange, for your input. I think that we have a real good conversation about quality literature here tonight. Thank you all for coming. Thank you, Iris, for interpretation. And a big round of applause for all these incredible authors.
非常感谢各位作家能够与我们进行分享他们关于文学的一些观点。那么今天晚上也是特别开心，非常感谢，再次感谢大家。
Thank you.